coverage of an African safari and may include animal kills and carcasses. Viewer discretion is advised.
Good afternoon, everybody. There are some buffalo, there are some waterbuck, and this is Safari Live.
Ready.
Standing by.
It is a balmy 30 degrees here in the middle of the Sabi Sand Game Reserve, that is on the western fringes of the Kruger National Park, which in turn is, well, in the northeast corner of South Africa. South Africa, the southern end of the African continent, and way above that, of course, planet Earth. That's about as far as I'm able to zoom out. Kirsten, did you get the map in during that time? The map failed. Okay, you were supposed to see a very sophisticated graphic as I said that, everybody. Anyway, we'll get it right sometime during the course of today. It's, I say, about 30 degrees Celsius. That's about 85 degrees Fahrenheit. My name is James Henry. On camera today is David. That's David's thumb. He's wearing a very sort of a quite fancy hat today, I must say. It's very summery, very kind of bush chic, if you like. Right, on we go. There's enough of that. On the other vehicle, of course, Pyjamas Patterson. She is with Gendre the Dreadlock, and they're heading towards Cheetah Plains this afternoon. They're going to see what they can find there. We are going to go towards the Nkahuma Pride, which were found by Rexon this morning. Rexon, in turn, is going down to look for Tingana at the south of the reserve. He was seen crossing north into the reserve today, not with Shadow, but I suspect Shadow will be following him. So he's going to go and fossick about there and see what he can find. We'll go and have a look at the lions. The plans will no doubt change at least five or six times during the course of the afternoon. We're just going to have a quick look at the beefaloes and the waterbuck. Well, I tell you that we'd love to hear from you during the course of the afternoon, the next 3 hours or so. Please do talk to us. Hashtag Safari Live if you're on Twitter, or questions at wildearth.tv if you're on the email. And it is a relatively blustery day, a northwesterly wind blowing, unsurprisingly, out of the northwest, and it's quite kind of hazy and cloudy, and I wonder if there ain't some weather blowing in at some stage. I doubt it will bring rain. I might be wrong. It will be, obviously, David, it would be the first time I've ever been wrong in my life before, but it is possible, I suppose, albeit unlikely. Now, that buffalo and his friends have been sitting around the water here, and I'm so glad they've taken up residence again. That particular buffalo looks like he's on his last legs, to be honest. He's not in a good way. Very hungry, possibly. He really is looking a bit skinny. Let's hope it rains soon so that he can get some new grass into his belly and recover from whatever disease is ailing him. And the big thing about the buffalo, of course, is that none of them in the Kruger National Park are what we describe as disease-free. And that means that they are affected by things like bovine tuberculosis and corridor disease. Now, almost certainly, these buffalo are carrying bovine tuberculosis in the same way that many people carry human tuberculosis, but we don't express it because, you know, we have enough to eat. We live in conditions that don't allow for the disease to take hold. Now, with the buffalo, that is exactly the same story. It doesn't affect their lives at all, except during such a thing as a drought like this. And what you find is that they are nutritionally sort of restrained, if you like, not enough to eat, not enough to drink, and so the disease starts to take hold. And I think that's probably what's happened to that rather skinny looking fellow there. And that's the story here. There were some waterbuck, not waterbuck, what are those small pig things? Ah, warthogs, yes. They were wandering down into the dam here. I'll just see if I can find them. But while I do that, let's head across to Pyjamas Patterson and find out how close to Cheetah Plains she is.
Good afternoon and welcome on the Sunset Safari. My name is Jamie and this afternoon I have Jandre on camera with me once again with his deeply, grievously injured foot from this morning where he dropped a marula log on it. And the answer to the all-important question about where exactly we are and how far we are on our journey to Cheetah Plains was I got distracted, slightly, by the prospect of relocating Tingana and Shadow. Unfortunately, with tears in my eyes, I have to tell you that Tingana and Shadow have crossed south back into Little Gowrie. So this morning, I know that James is updating you about this morning and the fact that we had three leopards on our southern boundary, all of them south of our boundary, until right up at the end when Tingana crossed to the north. And unfortunately, it seems as though he's gone back south again. Luckily for us, Master Tracker Rexon is helping us out this afternoon. He's going to come and trundle along here and check to see whether or not the Queen of Juma, who was last seen disappearing roughly here. Corrugations in the road. I don't remember those being there when I was last here. She disappeared roughly in this general direction. 2 wards, Little Gowrie and the Cheetwa boundary. So, Rexon is going to double check along this boundary, make sure that I don't miss her crossing. I, of course, don't want to be the one that missed her crossing, therefore I'm going to check carefully as well. And then we're going to make our way to Cheetah Plains. I'm sure that James has already touched upon the fact that summer is pretty much well and truly here, with temperatures reaching 89 degrees Fahrenheit. Degrees Fahrenheit, which is 32 in centigrade for those of you in the much largest of parts of the world. So it's hot this afternoon, so I'm thinking a couple of visits to Cheetah Plains Pan, three in a row Pan, will provide us with maybe some lovely elephant sightings, perhaps some buffalo wandering through, to go and have a drink on a hot and dusty afternoon. So that is our plan for now, and I think it is a relatively good one, since so far these impala are the first life forms I have seen, or at least mammalian life forms that I have seen, all standing in the shade of a balanites tree. Now all the animals seem to be hiding away from the blistering temperatures. Ram, young ram attempting to test the scent of the various females, and they're all just wandering away from him, looking to see whether or not any of them are going to come into estrus, and then getting to a nice patch of, well, I say a nice patch of grass. He's found something, somehow he's found something edible there. I have no idea how these animals are managing to eke out an existence on what they have here. It's mind-boggling. Another thing that we can do, this time of year, is we see far further into the vegetation. We were just talking about it earlier and the fact that you can. I mean, we really do have such an increase in visibility. We'll probably see about double the distance of what we usually see, not more in summer. What that does mean is that we often make mistakes and spot things like lion logs, which is what I'm trying to work out now because my binoculars are, of course, broken. I'm trying to work out what is that what that yellow thing is over there. See the yellow thing there? No. You mean you don't see the unnamed yellow thing? No. Let's go forward a bit. I'm pretty sure it's a log. Never fear, Jandre. I'm pretty sure it's a log. Jandre, of course, excelled himself this morning whilst on camera in spotting a pearl-spotted owlet. Those things, for those of you in the know, are exceptionally tiny. I mean, they really are. They're hand-sized owls, and somehow Jandre managed to spot one earlier this morning, which was incredibly impressive. I was suitably impressed. It's just a stone. Just a stone. Annalisa! Good afternoon and welcome to the Sunset Safari. I'd like to know, Jandre, how many times you've been injured whilst working for Safari Live?
None.
Uh-huh, sure. He's not a very good liar, Jandre. Especially not because half of us have driven you to the doctor at one point or another, so we know that's not true. Jandre says his heart is injured every time he goes on drive with James. I think James is actually quite horrible to Jandre. I'm not going to be as horrible to Jandre. I will say that he is accident prone. It might be true. It's definitely true. Jandre is very accident prone. He's had the nail in the foot and he's had the jack to the foot. I think those were the two big major foot injuries while he's been here. The nail was awful. And then he's had one or two unpleasant diseases, like stomach bugs and so on, because that sounded terrible. One or two unpleasant stomach bugs that we've had to take him to the doctor, but then we all have. So he's actually not that bad. He just seems to have an injury every now and again. He's very, very professional to the point that he often accidentally puts himself in harm's way, as he did this morning. I'm going to be nice to Jandre and say that it is a symptom of his professionalism that he manages to injure himself all the time. James, on the other hand, as we heard, hurts Jandre's heart every time Jandre goes out on drive with him, so I think we'll send you back over to James and find out what he thinks of that.
We're descending into the valley of the Great Mluamati drainage line. David, are you nervous? Are you wearing your wetsuit? Oh dear. Now, obviously I'm being totally ridiculous. This is where the Mluamati drainage line crosses onto Juma. There, the Buffalo cut line is just up there. And you can see it must have one stage been a roaring torrent of water cascading down through the low felt, cutting a swathe through the granitic rocks underneath here. No longer. Now what I've just picked here,
Oh dear, it seems as though James has laughing. James has disappeared off your screens. The reason I'm chuckling is because we were just currently discussing Jandre's multiple reasons for visiting the doctor. He's clarified that he did not, in fact, need to go for a stomach bug, but he did need to go when he was feeling terrible. Anyway, we finished that conversation. Now moving on rapidly, please. And we're on our way towards Cheetah Plains. Now we're about to hit the gremlin-filled hollow, as Brent describes it. It's also one of the places where we have the best chance of seeing Tundi. Now Tundi, for those of you who are new to this Safari Live experience, is a female leopard with two brand new cubs. Well, they're brand new. What are they? They must be 3 months old now. Must be close to 3 months old. And she gave birth to them, or at least denned them in the first few days of their life, underneath one of the guest rooms in a lodge called Chitwa. This is one of her main territorial areas, and she spends a lot of time in a river system known as the Mulwanini. And that's where she's been seen over the last few days, moving between Chitwa and Chitwa on my right, Tortured on my left, with the river system in between. Now before we hit the river system, where we will lose signal, I can guarantee, let's find something to talk about while we try and figure out. Never mind, he's up and running. James is working absolutely perfectly, and presumably Rusty is as well. We'll go across and find out what happened there.
What happened, everybody, is that the aerial fell backwards I, of course, blamed David immediately, but that was probably a little bit unfair. So, as I was saying before we were rudely interrupted, there is the pod of the russet bush willow. Now, you can see they're blowing off, of course, because they are four-winged, and they are four-winged in order to pick up the wind and be distributed about the low veld where they might grow. Now, apparently, they're supposed to be a good tea substitute. I have used them for tea, and as it is, tea time is sort of between 4 and 5 o'clock, depending on your bent. My mother and father will have it at 5 o'clock exactly. Some will have it at 4 if they're in the lodges around here. But I must just tell you that the russet bush willow is a very poor tea substitute. I've tried it many times, and it is really not great at all. Now, we've come off-road here to find the lions of the Nkuhuma pride, which I believe to be here. Slightly worryingly, there's a waterbuck close by. You can just see them up through there, beautifully camouflaged. Can you see them there, David? There you are, you've got them there. That's it. You can see how perfectly coloured they are. They are the best camouflaged antelope out here. Kirsten, all I heard there was whoop. Ooh, what is that? There's a very enthusiastic woodpecker over there towards the lions. Let's go and take a look. Oops. Oops again. It's a clear path here. I've hit every tree next to it. Now, Rickson farmed them in here this morning. I don't know if you were on drive with us this morning. But the Nkuhuma pride, all of them, sans any of the Birmingham males, were just in here. I don't think they would have gone anywhere. Apparently it's actually 32 degrees Celsius, 89 degrees Fahrenheit. So that's pretty warm for the 5th of September, I'd say. And I imagine there'll be one or two cold snaps left, certainly if you were living on the high veld, which is the areas around Johannesburg and Pretoria, which are just over a mile high in some cases. And I think they will probably experience another winter snap or two. But here, we're into the heat. And hopefully, with La Niña, we'll be into some rain as well. Ah, hello Annie in British Columbia while we drive through here. An interesting question. You're wondering about hermaphrodites, basically, or sort of semi-hermaphrodites. Some fish, as we know, can change sex, like you say, and you want to know if there are any animals out here that can perhaps change sex according to what is required and who is needed. No, the short answer is, as far as I know, not. There might be, I mean, I don't know about the tilapia and the catfish out here. I'm pretty sure they can't. But it's possible that they could, I suppose. But I don't think so. And I don't think any of the reptiles can either. The most hermaphroditic animal that we get out here is the giant land snail. I think they are hermaphrodites. Which means that when they mate, they both exchange male spermatophores between each other. And they, oh, there's the entire pride. And so the giant land snail, Annie, would be about the closest we've got. They have moved exactly 2.5 meters, 7 feet, since we last saw them. Now, we need to get into a position where they're not terribly frightened by us. I'll go in here, Davy. Hello, ladies. Yes. It's us again. I know it must be very confusing to you as to why we are always here, but we just do find your children so very exciting. You, at this time of the day, are about as exciting as drying paint, but your kids, they are fascinating all the time. Now, Dave, just beyond there, there's a Natal spur fowl that the little cubs are looking at. You see that? Just behind there, it's down, right there, just there it is. Natal spur fowl. And I'm just going to sneak forward. Sorry, let me just sneak forward. It might make a little bit of noise, but the little cubs are watching it carefully. And I wonder if they aren't going to have a bit of a go. No, it's run off. There are two of them in there. That's as far as I can go, I'm afraid. That's what that little lioness is looking at. You can see she's a little lioness. It's such fun because they're always a little bit awake, these cubs. They're very seldom completely flat cat, as their parents are. Yes, I am talking about you, madam. And I think, isn't it amazing how, I mean, that bird is no idiot. If the bird was an idiot, it wouldn't be alive. It would have been eaten some time back. Clearly, some form of realization that these cubs don't pose an actual danger to it. It won't be long before they do try and stalk something like a little bird and catch it. And there, the little teddy bear one on the right-hand side there, those are the youngest ones. Others getting up now, having a bit of a stretch. Looking a little bit skinny, I must say, at this stage, those ones. But that's normal, you know. I think they're going through a growth spurt as they push towards weaning, which will only be in about, probably about 8 weeks or so. But they've started eating meat. And this, it's quite interesting. If I was to describe the phases or nutritional phases of a lion's life, assuming the mother is able to produce sufficient milk, I'd say the first 6 weeks a very good time for them. They can drink as much as they like, no competition because they're not in the pride, and so sweet. No competition within the pride because they're not introduced to the pride. Then 6 weeks up to 6 months, let's say 6 weeks to 12 weeks, they're in the pride. And so there is a bit of competition for the milk, especially if they're slightly older cubs. So that's quite difficult. And then, say, 12 weeks to 6 weeks to 6 months, the weaning process begins. And so that's also quite difficult. But they can still have milk. After that, once they've weaned, remember, nobody stands back at a kill, which means they have to fight for every piece of meat they get from then on. And that's when they're most nutritionally vulnerable, I think. And you'll see even these fat little things here will eventually start to look pretty, there's a wonderful Afrikaans term, skraal. They'll look pretty skraal. And I mean, skraal basically means skinny. But it's I'm sure you can imagine what I mean when I say skraal. They'll start to look a little bit haggard and skinny and ribby. And that's perfectly normal. So don't worry when it happens. There's one just trying to find something to drink there. Is that a lactating female? No, it's not. That's not a lactating female, so I'm afraid he's going to be sorely disappointed if he latches on to one of those. It must be Amber Eyes or the other one that isn't with child yet. Amber Eyes might be with child, as it were. She has been mating. I don't think that's a lactating female. Maybe it is. I can't see exactly. Certainly enough youngsters making an effort to see if they can get a bit of a meal out of her. And unlike with any other mammal, of course, or with very few other mammals, they will cross-suckle. Hello, safari slave. May you be emancipated as soon as possible, safari slave. You say, do I know how many males and females are born here? In the youngest crew, which are now 7 or 8 weeks old or so, yes, I do, 2 males, 1 female. In the oldest crew, we think that there are 2 females and 1 male, and we think in the middle crew, That's the 11-week-old ones. We think that they are two lionesses. That's what we think. They don't, as Jamie pointed out very obviously to me the other day, sit still for any length of time. And so it's quite difficult to tell. But certainly the three smallest ones have been fairly easy to sex because we saw them a lot on their own. That's a lovely question from One Wolf in South Carolina. Dave, if you can get on that, yeah, focus in on that one there, and it's flicking tail. One Wolf, you said, what stage basically does the pom-pom arrive at the end of the tail? You can see that that one there, which I think is one of the older ones, 14-week old or so, it's starting already to get a little bit bigger. So I'd say by 6 months they'll have a pretty good pom-pom. In the case of one of the Birmingham boys, of course, who I dubbed Skinny Pom-Pom, he didn't really get much of a pom-pom at all. So I'd say by about 6 months they'll have a good-sized pom-pom on the end of their tails. I tell you, I sit here and I'm looking at these things and I watch how the cubs flop all over their mothers. It's almost difficult for me to justify or understand to myself, if I got out of the car, the reaction these animals would have. It looks like you could walk over there, lie down next to them and kind of join in the lion carpet there and have a wonderfully relaxed afternoon with them. That is not the case, David. You would be bitten several times if you tried to do that. Yes. Right. From lions, we go across to those who were faster than Michael Johnson and now faster than Wade Funnykirk.
I would be very, very impressed if these guinea fowl could outpace Wade Funnykirk, but you never know. Funnily enough, I was thinking about ostriches and seeing ostriches on cheetah plains. Well, we've got a bird. It's not quite an ostrich, but they can be as equally entertaining. We've got a flock of helmeted guinea fowl pecking about through the open area. We're not quite at the full open area of Cheetah Plains, so all the way towards the Kruger National Park boundary and closer to the lodge side. But we've got 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15, 16. Lots of guinea fowl. I give up. And they really are such fascinating birds to watch. The way that they run, the way that they move. We watched some recently we did watch some about 5 months ago, sitting with Tingana, and it was one of the funniest sightings I've had, I think, since I started working at Safari Live. I don't know what that was all about. And it was the guinea fowl would walk past the leopard, and then all of a sudden they'd spot him and go, chuck, 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 and give their alarm call. And then go back to feeding and walk around him and then see him again and start alarm calling again. It was like they completely forgot that he was there. Like they had some kind of major short-term memory loss. It was absolutely hilarious. Feathers gusting about in the wind. It is very, very breezy this afternoon. It's going to be very windy on the open plains of Cheetah Plains. That is where we are heading to. Look at them. They've all synced. The movements of their walk have all synced up. That was amazing. They were all walking in unison for a second there. Oh, that's lovely to hear from Gretchen in Illinois. Gretchen apparently was just thinking that we haven't seen guinea fowl in a while and that they are her son's favourite. Oh, there we go. Guinea fowl, they're actually one of my favourites as well. Unfortunately, they're now streaming off in a great flock somewhere else. For sort of no rhyme nor reason. It just seems to be that's the direction they're all dashing off in. Gretchen, I understand. I think they're thoroughly entertaining. They're also very beautiful birds. As our guinea fowl slowly disappear off into the bush, we don't want to keep you away from those wonderful tawny cats for too long. We're going to race over to Cheetah Plains Pan, see if anything's come for a drink. In the meantime, let's jump on board with James and those lions.
I hope you all got my reference there. In case you didn't, I'm not sure if you did. Michael Johnson, previous world record holder for the 400 metres with 43 point... What was it? It was 43 point... Oh, gosh, I've forgotten. About 43.3 seconds, I think that's what it was. That's pretty quick. A guinea fowl can do it in 28 seconds, which I think is quite astounding. And Wade Vernikerk has just broken Michael Johnson's record, of course, at the Olympics from South Africa. 43.03 seconds for the 400-meter sprint. Ooh, very cross line there. But still, nowhere close to the speed of the humble guinea fowl, which, if you could make it run around a track, could apparently do it in 28 seconds. So if you placed raisins, I suppose, at a sufficiently spaced intervals, then maybe we could get Wade Vernikerk to race a guinea fowl. I'd love to do that, actually. Be an amazing safari live story. Wade Vernikerk versus a guinea fowl. The other advantage to cubs, of course, is what they do is they wake up the adults, which means that they do the odd moving around. There is our friend Amber Eyes. So she was the female they were trying to suckle off. She was also, of course, featured in that wonderful clip that has gone viral on the internet. I love to be able to say that something from Safari Live has gone viral. It's had over 5 million views, and that's of Amber Eyes hugging one of these little cubs. Is it 12 million?
Yes.
12 million people have viewed Amber Eyes hugging one of the cubs. It's now 15 million. I'm getting updated counts every time we speak. Sorry, no, what's that? 1 billion. Okay, good. 1,000 million people have seen it. No, I'm kidding. 15 million people have watched Amber Eyes hugging one of these little cubs. And everybody who's watched it thinks that Amber Eyes is the mother. And that's obviously not the case, but clearly she is very affectionate with these little ones, as evidenced by the fact that she was tolerating them trying to suckle from her just now. Just now, of course, a South Africanism meaning just now. I mean, a little while ago. There's much crossness now. Hello, Sheila. You want to know how the lionesses know which cubs are theirs? I think it's probably from smell. They're not particularly worried about it. They're all related to each other, and you can see that they are, I mean, they're all kind of in a big sort of mess, but they do cross-suckle, so they don't worry too much about whose is whose. I'm sure they do know, though, and I'm pretty sure they know from smell. I know, you say, Catherine, you say you love how the cubs walk all over their mums. I love it too. David, what are you laughing at?
No.
My photograph?
No.
Oh, good. You better not be. I think David's lying, everyone. I think he was laughing at my photograph. Don't blame him. They're fairly horrendous efforts. I missed all of that action, didn't get any. Thank you, Thomas in Pennsylvania, for asking me a question I can't answer and therefore rendering me an imbecile while on live safari. You say, where does the word pride come from? And I'm ashamed to say, Thomas, that I do not know, and I think it's a really good question. So let's see if any of our viewers know. Hashtag Safari Live, question to wildlife.tv. Tell us if you know where the word pride comes from. I'd be fascinated to know. That's a really good question. Thank you, Thomas. All the way from Pennsylvania. And the noises they make is just so very wonderful. Sorry, Kirsty, you're going to have to give that to me again. Rexon was on the radio at the time. Can we go again, please? Ah, a question from Jerry, not an FC. Jerry, a nice one from you. When will they try to kill on their own first? I think almost as soon as they wean. So probably about 6 months will be the first time they might try and make a kill them. I'd try a little bit earlier, but I think that's probably when they would try. You saw them looking at that Franklin earlier, but not making any effort to try and sort of grab at it. So I think you'll find that it will probably be round about 6 months when they wean and they start thinking about meat as opposed to milk. Then they'll start the instinct to hunt and sort of kill will kick in. That would be my guess, Jerry. And that was not a question from Jerry in the final control. So Jerry, if you ask us another question, tell us where you're from. You don't want to be confused with Jerry from the final control. She dislocated her knee today. So she's feeling quite deeply sorry for herself. I don't blame her. I feel quite sorry for her too. Do you, David? Poor Jerry. She was, I think, trying to hang a curtain, if I'm not mistaken. I'm going to be in trouble when I get home now. It's quite a sweet scene, this now. Everything's calmed down for the next 5 minutes or so. Whereupon one of the cubs will move, irritate somebody, and it will all get a little bit active again. And this is the joy of having cubs. And please excuse the noise of this camera, everybody. The reason I'm... Forget what I was going to say. Jamie's got something absolutely astonishing to show you. It's a piece of wood.
We do indeed have a piece of wood, and there's something. We've actually got two pieces of wood, and there's something very, very special about them. Or at least there's something very special about one of them. And you may have guessed it. It's not that one. It is this one here, which is, of course, not a piece of wood. Although you could, I could actually have found a better one, but I tried to do that in a hurry to find one that looked more like this particular creature. But it is absolutely amazing. It really is. It's a stick insect, and I want to show you. Oh, it's okay, buddy. Come here. Hello. Have a look at the little protrusions on this chap's... This is an insect. I mean, this is a real live insect. Just look at the protrusions on his legs that are meant to look like dried leaves. How absolute... There, you can see he's moving of his own accord, so he is a real stick insect. I promise, he's not a stick. Look at it, it's incredible. Those little folds out there that are meant to be the leaves. And then the joints of the legs that look like joints of, you know, a stick. Every now and again he tries to find his way. I'm going to turn him round now. Look at, there you go, you've got the little grooves all the way along the tail. And of course he moves so incredibly slowly. Even though I've now picked him up, he doesn't know if he's been spotted just yet, and he's still pretending very, very carefully that he's a stick. I'm a stick, I'm a stick, I'm a stick, I'm a stick. I promise I'm a stick. I'm not anything edible, I'm a stick. You just turn him round so that I can show you his face. There we go. Have a look at that. Okay, so his two legs are in the front there. How cool is that? His two legs join together to make him look even more elongated. And his head is sort of roughly there-ish. And he's so light that he's even blowing in the wind. Oh, look at him go! Shame, buddy! Oh, shame, I feel bad. I'm going to bring him back down a little bit so he's a bit more sheltered. Although, of course, this is what stick insects do. They sit and they blow in the wind and they pretend to be a stick. And how anything could see through that. The only reason that I saw him, actually, was he was on my door when I opened it to get out and put my antenna up. He's amazing. Absolutely fascinating. I think he should be called Steve the Stick Insect because I'm going to start adopting James's approach, naming things. So this is Steve the Stick Insect, and I think he should travel along with us because that's where he was before to start with. We'll take him back and we'll find him a nice home at Juma. Hey Steve, what do you think? I'm a stick, I'm a stick, I'm a stick, I'm a stick. I'm a stick, I swear. Oh, shame. Legs are blowing in the wind. So these are his two front legs here. I don't want to hurt him. He is absolutely magical. His foot's looking for purchase on my finger, on the tip of my finger. There we go, he's found it. The left front foot is longer than the right front foot, which makes total sense because it means that the right front foot can sort of hook onto the other one and cling on. And now he's starting to just ever so gently cling on to me. And he's gone back to being a stick. I'm a stick. I'm a stick, I'm a stick, I'm a stick. I'm Steve the Stick Insect. And I'm a stick. He's amazing. I think I'm going to take Steve with us. He can come on our safari and join us and be a good luck charm. Hey Steve, what do you think? Yes, no, look to the left. I agree, James Richard. I think that you may be right. So apparently there was recently a debate as to which, and I'm going to turn him now slightly, which animal has the best camouflage in the bush. I think, James, you're right. I think the stick insect is the winner of this particular competition. I mean, he's next to indistinguishable. They're absolutely the most mind-boggling creatures. Okay. Well, I think I've held him relatively steady, considering. I mean, I think that's quite impressive. I'm not shaking. It's him blowing in the wind. It's been most impressive, but it cannot continue forever, and at some point I'm going to have to put my arm down. Okay, let's pop him down. All right, Steve, where would you like to go? I want to take you back to Juma and pop you at the DRC. I think he's been with us the whole time, you know. I think he might actually have come from the car park itself. We shall put you, put you on the brown of my jacket. There you go. There you go. Now there you can be a stick. Whoops. Oh no. There's a fallen stick. Come on, Steve. There you go. There you go. Steve the Stick Insect, everybody. Can be our companion for the sunset safari. Right. On that note, off we go. He's perfectly fine. He's perfectly positioned. Oh. All right, Steve, are you ready? Yep. Okay, let us make our way. We're almost at three in a row pan. Let us go and see what's happening there. And welcome to Finn, who is 8 years old. And of course, I said we're keeping Steve with us. Steve the Stink Insect. And Finn wants to know, well, what animals would want to eat an insect like that? And Finn, the thing that eats most stick insects is a bird. So different types of bird. It could be a lilac-breasted roller, you know, the really beautiful ones with the bright purple chests, or something like a kingfisher, because even though their names have fisher in them, only one species of kingfisher fishes. The rest of them eat insects. So it could be a kingfisher. Lots of different types of birds. Some species of frogs might also eat him, although I haven't seen any frogs just yet. They're still waiting for the rain to come out and start to croak and move about. And we're waiting for the frogs, but a frog might eat it. And a chameleon. A chameleon is one of our favorite reptiles to look at. Here we go. We've got a hornbill in the road. There's another creature that would eat the stick insect. Shh, don't tell him about Steve. He's busy now. Collecting termites. Well, this is an animal that might eat a stick insect. A yellow-billed hornbill. And you can see he's very busy picking up insects in elephant dung. So he's not actually eating the elephant's dung. He's sifting through it to look for the different creepy crawlies that live in it. Whether it's ants or termites or whatever else he might find there. It's okay, Steve. I promise I won't tell him about you. You can see him checking out the different piles of elephant dung. And those look relatively fresh. Not fresh, not in the last few moments, but definitely in the last few hours. So there's elephants somewhere here on Cheetah Plains. That's up to us to go and find them. I feel like we could use a really nice elephant sighting on this warm afternoon. Steve agrees. Steve says that they're his favorite animal. I don't really want to interrupt this hornbill. He looks so serious. Aaron in New Zealand would like to know if Steve could please be in the credits, which I think is only fair, and he could be credited as head stick. Probably not, Aaron, but I like the idea. I think it would be really, really nice. We can have Steve, the head stick insects, and Monty, the mantid, and it's a dangerous path, Aaron. We could end up... Oh, sorry, no, we can't have Monty the mantid. Monty was a positive squirrel. Forgot about that. Sorry, Mr. Hornbill. Get just very, very disgruntled look from you. Sorry, I'm going, I'm sorry. I know I interrupted your lunch. You can't have Steve. He's ours. Quick, before he spots him. Not that he would spot him at all, because Steve looks like a stick. Oh, this is where, sorry, to go back to the Finn's question about things that eat stick insects. This is where the slightest bit of movement would give our special stick insect away. Even something like a big mantid could potentially eat a stick insect, although probably not one of Steve's size. But a praying mantis is one of the few animals or one of the few insects that has proper three-dimensional vision and would be able to catch a stick insect. And then chameleons, of course, as a member of the reptile family, they naturally have that. But they've also got those, yay, there's an elephant in the pan. They've also got those movable eyes, individually controllable eyes. Obviously, I'm now being a chameleon's eyes. That allow them to pick out things like stick insects and actually manage to catch them. Hello, elephants. Yay. This is what I was hoping for. Oh, look at this. Sorry, before we get too much closer, just interesting situation playing out with a young female being pushed by a male. I think it's a male at the back. Definitely a massive size difference. And then a little calf in between. Okay. Oh, all is calm now. Oh, we can shuffle up a little bit closer. Hello, guys. Thank you. bit upset. Just let's stop here for a moment and just gauge what's happening. Somebody's not happy. This female's not happy, and I don't know if it's because she's being harassed by a male. Or if it's... it could be the wind. It is very windy. And it looks like that is a male that's there behind the calf. So he might be the one that's causing that discomfort. See? You can really see her unhappiness. Oh, I thought I squashed Steve, but it's okay. It's an actual stick. It's all right. You can actually see her unhappiness. The body language, the sort of swaying backwards and forwards. She's really thirsty. So she's not going to be deterred for too long. I'm just gauging by the size difference between the elephant behind her and the elephant that we're looking at. I'm relatively certain that that is a male behind, causing trouble. And a little calf desperately reaching down for trunks full of water. Okay, you can reposition now. They've calmed down. Just wanted to make sure that we didn't stumble into the middle of a disagreement. As you can imagine, getting into a domestic dispute between elephants is really not something, not a position you want to find yourself in at all. A domestic dispute is one thing, and we've experienced enough of those recently with the mating leopards and Karula. But a domestic dispute with a 5-ton animal is a slightly different matter. Hi guys. All right. It's okay, girl. It's all right. What's the matter? Have those boys been stressing you out? She's also not the best condition I've seen. Her hip bone's sticking out a little bit. A lot of our elephants are now starting to look slightly thinner than they should. Which, you, as you can imagine, it's very difficult to sustain their body weight during times like these where there's so little food around. That might also account for her and a sort of higher than normal level of discomfort. It's all right, girl. Has that male been causing big troubles? Calf. They're standing where the water, the pumped water, comes out. So it's the freshest and the cleanest water, rather than trying to drink from where it's muddy. And I think that's also why there's been a little bit of conflict, because the big bull on the right is the one that's monopolized the best drinking spot. The other question in terms of conflict between our different animals is, it's from Stephen in Ohio, do we ever interfere with the animals, or do we ever... Well, the question was actually, do we ever want to? We don't. We never interfere unless an injury to an animal or a problem with an animal has been caused by human impact, direct human impact. Otherwise, we let nature take its course. Nature's been doing it for far longer and does it far better than we do. And there's certain things that we don't necessarily totally understand in terms of the way in which things fit together. In terms of animal conflict with each other, no, we would never intervene in that sort of scenario. The only time maybe we might is if it involved an endangered species, but even then, not in an area like this. Maybe in slightly smaller reserves, perhaps, but not in this kind of area. Oh, shame, look at them. Tossing mud back over their shoulders. But we do provide water, so 3-in-a-row pan is pumped. Otherwise, we would see, I mean, we would have absolutely no animals here. The only ones that we'd see would be dead because the drought situation is so bad. We've got no rivers here in the northern Sabi sand. So the animals would have absolutely nothing to sustain themselves on. There we go. Have a drink, guys. They've been joined by a couple more elephants, and the cows have to content themselves with the muddy patches of water. whilst the bull has wrapped his trunk around the pipe where the water comes out, and he's actually, from what I can see, he's actually sucking it up straight from the pipe itself. The little one wants to join him. There you go. He is. He's taking it straight out of where it's coming through the piping. What often happens... Oh! Oh, that's gorgeous. Oh, come on, dude. Shame. Right. As if that needed any interpretation, well, that elephant bull just pushed the baby elephant out of his way. But what was wonderful about that was how gently he did it. I mean, he's an absolutely enormous animal. He is easily 4 or 5 times the size of that little calf. And he just ever so gently nudged him out of the way with his foot. Sad to see. You feel sorry for the little one. But at least he did it gently and he didn't kick him hard. Beautiful scene. More elephants on their way. Approaching tentatively. There you go, that backwards and forwards swaying motion of the front leg immediately indicates indecision. Ah, not a popular arrival. A submissive turning of the body from the elephant that was coming in, and the female's pushing it away ever so slightly. Now, speaking of our pumped water and pumped pans, Liz, you wanted to know if perhaps we didn't pump these pans, would we see more arid dwelling species during this drought? The answer is no, probably not, although I completely understand where you're coming from, because of course this area, before these pumped dams were provided, we would never have seen hippo at all, and we would have seen more animals like sable antelope, because they're more adapted towards dwelling in arid conditions. But now they've been outcompeted by animal species that have been brought in by the pumped pan. But that change has been effected over quite a long period of time, and we're talking decades at a time, rather than one small drought period, rather than a year or two drought. So whilst we might see maybe one or two sable over the next few months whilst it is a drought, that's more just because they're being pushed in to find water. It's not because they're starting to make a comeback, if that makes sense. It takes a lot longer for the impact that something like an established dam, a man-made dam, has on an ecosystem. Oh, don't waste. And the elephant just sprayed a trunk full of water. See the tentative approach of the young male. He's also thirsty. Careful, buddy. The big male, not in any way concerned. And the younger male on the left, definitely not brave enough to make any kind of a stand. Lucy, lovely to have your question as always. Lucy wants to know whether or not, if the mother had not been there, if perhaps the male would have been more forceful with the calf. I don't think so. I really, honestly, elephants are such special creatures, and they know that a little calf is small and fragile. Oh, it's a warthog, you silly thing. Did you get a big fright? Are you going to go and chase the warthog away now? Elephants can be such big sooks. Big wusses. The poor warthog was coming dashing up to have a drink and immediately got startled the elephant. And now the poor thing just wants to come and drink, and there is no chance. With two rowdy teenage boys, or at least one teenage male elephant, there's no way. There's something about young male elephants that they love to spend their times chasing things that are smaller than them around. I think it makes them feel big and scary. And it's also, there's probably a hormonal base to it as well. But Lucy, I think that that gentleness that we saw is just elephant-on-elephant interaction. I mean, how often? We never really hear of an elephant bull injuring a calf. Hey, you got your chance, little one. On the subject of our amazing elephants, and they are incredibly special creatures, Laura's read the terrible statistics that have come through in terms of elephant numbers. So they very recently released a giant census into the different animal, the different elephant numbers throughout Africa. And Laura, yes, it does mean that they're endangered. They are in sort of in total throughout Africa, they have become an incredibly endangered species. And I can't remember off the top of my head, what was it again? How many elephants were killed per hour or something horrifying? Sorry?
One every
15 minutes. So that's four an hour. Oh, he's going in. Let's watch him while we talk about this. It's an incredibly depressing statistic. He's going to go and give himself a mud bath. Laura, they are endangered. They're not endangered in South Africa. It's a difficult topic of conversation, but it is incredibly, incredibly sad to hear what's happened to elephant populations throughout Africa. South Africa, we've been very fortunate, at least with elephants, in that our elephant population at the moment, remains stable. It doesn't mean that that couldn't change in a heartbeat, but for now, these beautiful animals, in South Africa at least, are relatively safe. As you go further north throughout Africa, between civil war conflicts and funding of weaponry and the illegal poaching that then sets off, they are an animal species that has become incredibly endangered. It's such a difficult one because we wish in South Africa that we could take in all the elephants throughout the rest of Africa and take care of them, but we can't. Because an elephant is an animal that does tremendous damage if there's too many of them in a concentrated area. So if there's lots and lots of elephants, we don't have the habitat to support more elephants, if that makes any sense. They are endangered, just not luckily for us in South Africa. It's impossible to fathom, isn't it, when we sit and enjoy sightings like this, with their characters and their personalities. I don't begin to understand it. Well, no, I don't begin to understand it. And he's having a wonderful mud bath, unconcerned by the problems of the world. The weight of it does not rest upon his shoulder. All he's got to do is survive the drought over the coming months, and he probably will. He's got the advantage of bulk and size. Look at him standing like that. They're such surprisingly agile animals with his deeply curved back. Isn't he magnificent? Still not quite done. Scooping up little bits around the side. I was hoping that he'd walk right out into the middle of the pan itself and have a proper mud wallow. But he seems to be a bit too dignified for that. Oh, I'm just going to casually rest my trunk here. Very smooth. Now, as our magnificent elephant bull slowly strolls away as though he has all the time in the world. Andy, the reason that elephants have such wrinkly skin, no, it's not because of the drought, although it does make it worse. I must say, certainly their skin seems to hang a little bit more off their skeletons. But it's to increase their surface area, Andy. So, essentially, an enormous animal like an elephant, as I'm sure you know, the larger the volume of an animal, the smaller its surface area to volume ratio, and therefore the harder it is for that animal to cool down. So the wrinkled skin helps to tip the scales back in favor of having a slightly larger surface area for heat exchange. It also means that when they do things like on really, really hot summer's day, I mean, today is 32 as we spoke about before, but on a day that's 42 or even up to 50, when they go and they bathe themselves in wet mud, then it sticks to the cracks in their skin and it takes slightly longer to dry. And that essentially just helps to extend the cooling effect. Also just allows them a greater mobility in terms of those enormous joints and bones. As our beautiful animal disappears, and drink time, at least a three in a row pan, is complete, let's go back over to James and find out what his lazy lions have been up to.
Drink time has only just begun here, everybody, and the youngster's trying desperately to get some milk from that very patient mother. And as Dave was saying to me, he can't believe how patient they are. They do give the odd growl and the odd swat, but they are generally extremely patient with the... You can hear the cubs shouting there. I'll try and move just now and see if we can't get a slightly better view. And I was wondering, I don't know if any of you can perhaps tell me, #safarilifequestions@wild.tv, if Amber Eyes has ever had youngsters before. She's not the oldest lioness, but she's certainly not the youngest. And I'm wondering if she's ever had them before. And perhaps she was the mother of some of those that were killed, those two youngsters who met their end at the claws and teeth of the Birmingham boys. Now, Thomas, thank you very much for that wonderful information. You say that many animals, the collective nouns thereof, have been sort of devised on the basis of some sort of characteristic, either a vice or something admirable about them. And in the case of lions, because they were seen as regal, then regal and proud, so it was that they came to be known as a pride. I think it's fascinating also, therefore, that... a group of ostriches can also be called a pride, because ostriches figures of some sort of ridicule, I think, rather than regal. Perhaps a circus of ostriches would be a better term. Anyway, a pride of lions, and they are seen as regal, and I got into a little bit of trouble the other day because I described some of these lions as gangsters, but I really don't think that they are particularly regal in much of their behaviour, and they are like a kind of, they're a very closely knit group of friends, and they operate in a manner that is often sort of gangish, I guess, gangsterish. They like to steal from everything that they come across. They do some hunting, of course, but in some areas, especially down up in East Africa, they'll scavenge even more than they hunt. And I think the real royalty out here are those magnificent cats, the leopards. And of course, the elephants. The elephants, nobody can really dispute that a big bull elephant is the real king of the jungle. Not that we're in a jungle, David. No. lioness there, being extremely active here on this warm afternoon, rolling over. Now, those are the two lionesses who don't have youngsters. Those there, that's Amber Eyes with her back to us, and another one with her front to us now, her white belly. What I want to do quickly is just see if I can't identify exactly who she is. I think, if I'm not mistaken, and I stand to correction here, everybody, she's the second youngest lioness in this pride. I think that the youngest one, if I'm not mistaken, is the mother of the very small cubs. And Dave, can you see the one cleaning its little one there? And just watch there, when she opens her mouth, and look at the teeth and the gentleness with which she deploys those teeth. Isn't that amazing? Those massive, terrifying teeth. It's incredible how she's able to be so gentle with them when she wants to be. I think she's licking her cub, isn't she? Or is she licking her own paw? I'm not sure. Kirsten thinks she's licking her own paw, that's why she asked me the question. You can see the little one there trying desperately to not suffocate under the weight of her mother's leg while she tries to suckle there. They're so very cute, aren't they? Hello, Les. You're wondering about what happens when these lionesses go off to hunt, and do the cubs, are they left alone, or what happens? Les, they are normally left alone. It's not normal that one will stay with them. Sometimes the two that don't have cubs tend to split off a little earlier than the other three, and perhaps they go off hunting, or begin a hunt. But no, they will be left alone, and yes, it is dangerous, but they do become a lot more fearful once the lionesses are away. And they go totally silent. They won't talk to each other. They'll be very silent. And they'll stay in some thick bush. And you can sometimes find cubs that have been left. I mean, the first time and only time I've seen the Styx cubs, they were all on their own, actually out in the open, in that dam at Cheetah Plains. And the adults were nowhere to be seen. So they will leave them alone, yeah. And that's fine. I mean, they can stay hidden. And they manage to stay hidden and silent is the crucial thing, of course. But they are absolutely very vulnerable. I mean, when we found the three youngest ones here, when we found them, they were probably about a week or two old in a big drainage line just north of Biffles Hook Dam. And I think that they were tremendously vulnerable when they were there. They were on their own for sort of sometimes 24 to 36 hours at a time. And they were just lying in a little drainage line there, and if a hyena or a leopard or anything had come across them, would absolutely have killed them. And I think she's the youngest lioness. She's got the pinkest nose. And I think she's the mother of the very little ones. So this is wonderful. I was hoping Sarah would get hold of us. Sarah's 18 and in Ohio, and she's done quite a lot of research on the Nkuhuma Pride, I think, for some school projects. Sarah, thank you for getting hold of us again. You say that your research and a sort of fairly lengthy investigation of the family tree of the animals in the Nkuhuma Pride has revealed that Amber Eyes has not had cubs yet, and you've got records dating back to the early 2000s, which is quite interesting. I mean, I don't think Amber Eyes is probably... Do you know how old she is, Sarah? I would have put her at about... I would have put her at about 6 years old. So, I mean, if she has not had cubs at 6 years old, that is indicative that there might be a problem. Certainly she seems to be, I don't know, maybe a little bit more filled with testosterone than some of the others. She doesn't seem to mate as long as the others. She doesn't seem to be as interested in mating as the others. And maybe she's just, she isn't, maybe there's a bit of a hormonal change in her that isn't quite the same as it is for the others. I don't know. She's certainly, I think, all of our favourite lioness. But time will tell. She has been mating with the Birmingham boys. Right, well, I'm going to stay right here with the lions, and hopefully Sarah will get back to us if she knows anything further about Amber Eyes' history. While we do that, Jamie is with some more elephants on Cheetah Plains.
Lots and lots and lots of elephants. I actually just said to Jandre that I was going to try and skip around the herd that we were with to get to Cheetah Plains Pan and then meet them there as they went for an afternoon drink. Whereupon we came across what feels like half of the elephant population of the Kruger National Park. That's a slight exaggeration, of course, but there must be, I think from where we were with the rest of the herd at Three in a Row Pan, there must be at least 70 elephants between Three in the Row Pan and here. And they've just been incredibly unsettled, so I've stopped really far away for now to just investigate what on earth is going on, because there was much screaming and trumpeting and going on and on about something. Sounds like a young elephant throwing a tantrum, but then all of the females gathered around in that protective stance that they adopt. And where there was lots of rumbling, that deep bass contact call that they make to communicate with each other. And because it is a windy day, and elephants are very unpredictable on windy days, I just thought I'd give them some time and some space before we moved a bit closer. And I think that now it's a bit more relaxed and we can go and investigate. I'm really hoping for a stunning sighting in the open area of Cheetah Plains with all of these elephants. That's what I'm hoping their plan is. Also got to be quite careful at the moment. We better pull off the road, Jandre. There's a big elephant group coming up behind us. Okay, we're gonna sit here and we're gonna wait for them to come through. So what I'm doing in a situation like this, because that big male is behind them as well, so he's also pushed them a little bit, he's going to come and be a bit of a pain. He's going to come and stand over us. Well, there's a very good chance he's going to come and stand over us, so we're going to keep nice and still. In a situation like this, we're basically making sure that we've got an escape route, somewhere where we can go. We've got left plenty of space for the elephants to move past. And then essentially we take it from there. And as I said, we've got to be a little bit careful because it is windy. Oh! So much trumpeting, what's the matter? Everybody's making noise this afternoon. The other thing is that a lot of elephants come in from Cheetah Plains. Wow, this is incredible. There are so many elephants here. A lot of the elephants come in from the Kruger National Park, and that side of the Kruger National Park, that western side of the Kruger National Park, is basically uninhabited, which means that they hardly ever see people or vehicles, and they might be a little bit more unpredictable than our elephants might otherwise be. Hello guys, goodness gracious, there's so many of you all spread out. How absolutely magical. Elephants of all ages, from the oldest of females to the youngest little ones that are all protected and corralled up in the front there, away from any risks. Beautiful old cows that have come through. I have a serious soft spot for older elephants as well. I just always imagine that the decades of memories that they've established and the wisdom and the knowledge that they have. Come on, everybody. Go towards the open area. Let's have a really... Oh! Really nice sighting there. Two young bulls, one obviously older than the other, and playing the role of a little bit of a bully. Stopping to munch on some of the smaller leadwood trees that still have a bit of green on them. There, my girl. Where are you going? Where are you off to? Going to join the rest of the group. Okay, little one. It's all right. You can go. Tony, in Pennsylvania, a really lovely question coming through from you, which is, do elephants have different formations for different threats? And yes, probably you'll find that if you look close enough, they probably do. Their standard formation, which I'm sure you know, is that defensive ring with the little ones on the inside and the adult females on the outside, essentially circling them. But it depends on what the elephants are doing and what kind of situation that they're in. Because sometimes what will happen is the females will lead an attack going forward and the little ones will stay behind. Sometimes what they do is they put some females in front that sort of ferry the little ones away. And you probably find that that would be the situation if, for example, they were being hunted by lions. Which does happen. It's rare, but it does happen. What now? Shush. Cheeky little boy. He disagreed with something I said, clearly. You see that indecision? Backwards and forwards movement of the front foot, so rocking, and touching things that are clearly not food with his trunk. I mean, that marula tree is dead. It's long dead. He knows it's long dead. And then glancing backwards at me out of the corner of his eye. There we go, rocking again. And the thought process is, am I brave enough to try and scare this thing off? Am I big enough and scary enough yet? No, maybe not. I might go over there and bully a younger male instead. But yes, Tony, you'll probably find that there are specific different approaches between the different threats and the different formations, but it depends on what's happening and it will very much depend on the circumstances involved. Now, for example, you'll probably find, I mean, the young males always walk behind, but you'll probably find that there's a big cow waiting somewhere at the back of this herd to make sure that everybody is present and accounted for and okay. I'm looking for her now. She's probably standing under the shade of that marula tree, or she could be over there. But she's essentially acting as the rear guard. Not too concerned about the teenage males. They slowly lose their importance in an elephant herd. And indeed, towards their sort of sexual maturity, they actually get to the point where they're physically pushed out. I'm trying to think through the answer to the next question, which is from Valeria. Which is, what is the largest elephant herd that I've ever seen and where was it? And I'm just thinking about it seriously. I've often found myself where I used to work in a situation with close to 70, 80 elephants. That's a relatively regular experience. I think probably Valeria would have been the Kruger National Park, where we sat and we watched about 100 or so, 150 or so odd elephants walking past. I've never experienced the absolutely massive elephant herds of places like Botswana or Zambia, which is something that I would love to experience. I don't think I've ever sat with an elephant herd much larger than about 150. And of course, in places like that, you can get hundreds of elephants gathering together, possibly, you know, lots and lots of them moving, especially around the river systems, around the water systems. Little mister, you're going to block my way here. You're going to be a pain. Do you mind if I come past? I just don't want to scare him. Go on. And our elephants are slowly, slowly on their way back towards the Kruger National Park. And of course, they've got this vast open area of unfenced land that they can move between. Whether it takes them all the way to Mozambique or Zimbabwe, I've been to places where they can cross into Botswana, not where we are. But Jimelin? All right, let's just stop here, because shame, he's scared. And I don't want to scare him at all. He was all young and brave earlier, but now he's a little bit unsettled, so I'm just going to let him walk and catch up with the rest of the herd. Jimelin? Yes, ultimately there have to be fences at some point, which there are, that block off the reserve from neighbouring villages and communities. You wanted to know if it's a fence that can stop an elephant? No. There's no such thing, as far as I know, as a game fence, unless you are talking about something out of Jurassic Park. There's no real game fence that can keep elephants out. It's more as a sort of a physical barrier. It's most of the time they keep elephants out. They are electrified. They're electrified with a very, very high voltage, but a very low current. Did I get that right? Yes. Very high voltage, very low current. In other words, it hurts, but it won't kill anything unless something gets really stuck on it, like tortoises and pangolins sometimes do. But I mean, I've been shocked by them. It's not pleasant, but it definitely won't. And often elephants learn. We've seen it with some of the fences around the gardens in these places. Elephants can learn very quickly and very easily how to push over fences and how to get through them. While we wait for our elephant herd to make their way out into the open area, let's go back across to James and see whether those lion cubs are waking up.
Well, the lion cubs are very awake all the time, pretty much, here, and they've been playing and licking and biting and scratching each other and chewing sticks and chewing their mothers' tails and bugging their aunts and asking them questions about what life is like as a very big adult lion. And that's what I imagine they're asking about. David, I think that's pretty accurate, don't you? Yes. We have moved slightly, you may have noticed. We're in a slightly different position from the one we were in before. And it is rather sweet to watch these little things playing with each other. And they don't like to have an afternoon sleep, exactly the same as kids, human kids, where you try and tell them to go and have their afternoon sleep. They're just never that keen on it, are they? Heidi, you say you're always surprised at the size of the little cub's paws and how big they are in comparison with perhaps the adults. Heidi, it is amazing, and it's amazing because if you think, I mean, these cubs are tiny, right? They're probably, I don't know, the little cubs are probably about a foot and a half long, maybe. So they're very, very small indeed. But they're nothing like as big as, say, a leopard, but their tracks are now the size of a female leopard's track. So that's quite interesting to see. And you're absolutely right, they're big. And I mean, they're an indicator of how big the animal is actually going to be one day. And even those little leopard cubs, you know, they've got feet much bigger than you expect them to be. I was expecting them about, I don't know, about 2 months ago, I thought they'd be about civet-sized. But they were really much bigger than that. And Hosanna's are shortly going to be not much smaller than his mother's. In fact, they'll probably be... I'd say that Hosanna's tracks will probably be bigger than Karula's in the next 2 or 3 months. There is so much going on here. There, they are trying to suckle from... Oh no, that is one of the lactating females. Look at the one standing on there, Dave. Climbed straight onto the belly of a patient auntie. And this is quite cute to watch, everyone, but it is a precursor to the fighting that they will inevitably have to engage in if they want to eat at a kill. Because they will fight viciously amongst each other when they get to meat-eating stage. and they're already starting to. There is no honour amongst these fellows. Sarah, thank you very much. You say you've pinned Amber Eyes' age at around 7. I would agree with you. I would say she's about 6 or 7 years old, so I'm happy to go with your assessment of 7. And I missed the last little bit of what you said. The game drive radio exploded into my ear. But basically, I think you said it's difficult to say. And apparently, when the pride arrived on Juma, or was named on Juma here in 2006, Amber Eyes was not present. Yeah, that doesn't surprise me. She certainly doesn't look like a 10-year-old. A 10-year-old lioness would be looking fairly bedraggled by this stage. One of the lionesses here is probably close to 9, I would say. But a 10-year-old lion is quite an old lion. And 12 years would be very old, and 14 years unusually old. 15, unusually alive. The record, of course, out here for a male, there you can see trying again with a female who is not lactating and kind of begging now. The record for a male in this area, everyone, is about 16 or 17 years, and those were the old Sparta males down on the Sand River. And I don't think anyone has come close to that age here. You know, beyond that, the Mapocho pride, at least the Mapocho males, when they came in, they were probably about 5 and 6 years old. They didn't last more than 2 or 3 years, so they were definitely gone by the time they were 10. The Majingis, the Majingaland coalition, I think they're pushing about 10 now. They've been fairly long-lived. Matimbas, how do we know how old the Matimbas were? I think they were about 10 as well, actually. They looked sort of 10, 9 or 10 years old. Maybe a little bit older than that, and they didn't last beyond their 10th or 11th years as the dominant lions here. So that's all quite interesting. Thank you, Sarah, for that. Your research is valuable, and I hope you keep doing it. It's great stuff. Now, was about to point something out that I don't believe to be true anymore. That little lion there, Dave, the one closest to us, he's just starting to exhibit some kind of stalking behaviour. You see the kind of flattening of the ears? And now, no, rather eat the squarry bush, that's much better. Just to prove me wrong, obviously. And listen to them now, they're starting to fight. Hello, Lucian. You're a new viewer and it's wonderful to have you with us. I have a friend called Lucian, believe it or not. You say, is this the same kind of safari that a tourist would get to see? Lucian, it's exactly the same kind of safari. You'd be able to come in here. You'd be able to look at these lions, you'd be able to spend time with them and ask questions about them and engage with them in the same way. The only real difference, Lucian, is that on the sort of live safari, live type safari, you get to come back day in and day out without having to pay the fairly, well, shall we say, less than cheap fees that it costs to stay in the Sabi Sands. But yes, absolutely, there are guests coming in and out of these sightings all the time. I'm not sure why no one's come to see us here. I'm not sad about that. I'm quite enjoying having these cubbies to ourselves. Rather fun. Another patient mother there, you can see. Hitting away the odd fly as the youngster tries to suckle. Safari Ginny in Canada, I don't know the answer to your question, but I'm going to say probably not. You say, would the newborn's mother's milk be richer than the older mother's milk, or the mother of the older cubs? I don't think so. I think it probably just depends on the mother and how much she's eating and, of course, how much is being drunk from her. So I think what you'll find is that some of them just produce better milk and more milk. Now, for example, the youngster who produced the three little bears, as I like to call them, the fat ones. Oh, look, she's getting very cross now, Dave. Getting very irritated with them as they fight. Look at them fighting there. Now, I think she's produced particularly good milk. I can't remember seeing such amazingly fat little lions before. And I think you'll find that the older the mother gets, obviously, as it is with humans, so probably the greater the difficulty she will have in producing good quality milk. And the mother of the little ones, I think, is the youngest lioness that we have here. It's wonderful, you know, to sit like this. And there's always something going on, something interesting to look at. Somebody walking around, lying down, trying to have a suckle, stalking someone else. I mean, look at that ridiculous thing, Dave. You pan down slightly, that ridiculous little lion having a snooze there, practicing for adulthood. I mean, could not be more content if it tried, could it? Just loving life. And why shouldn't we? Life ain't going to ever get easier than it is right now for you, chum. So enjoy it while it lasts. I wonder if they know they've only got a 1 in 10 chance of making it to independence. Oh, stalking. Yes. Well spotted. Look at that. And that's the tiny little ones stalking there. Totally instinctual behavior. And again, I'm struck, you know, by the difference between the two leopard cubs and the lion cubs. And it's totally normal, but the lion cubs have to forge these social bonds from the time they are born. And they will play and lie in close contact with each other and feed next to each other and suckle next to each other and fight for food almost immediately. Shongile and Hosana could not possibly be described as enemies, I mean, but they are certainly nowhere near as affectionate with each other as the lions are, and that is not unusual, it's completely normal. A leopard must learn to live on its own from almost the beginning. And then the lion cubs, of course, will be social from day one. And they are the only social cats, remember? The other thing to ponder, of course, is that we have three different ages of cubs here. We have at least three males amongst the eight. And those three males, let's pretend now in 2 years' time that no other cubs have been born and they get tossed out eventually. Those three males, although they are on their own, at least not on their own, although they're of slightly different ages, will most likely form a coalition. Go ahead. And what happens is, therefore, you have these coalitions where they're not all brothers. And that's, I think, probably what's happened with the Birmingham boys, and it's certainly what happened with the Matimbas. I don't think they were brothers, I think they were cousins. Go ahead. I'm just trying to get hold of somebody hailing me on the radio. Good? You? I don't know why people need to ask how people are on the Game Drive radio. It becomes a telephone without a bill. No, just me. Affirmative, make your way. It hurts me to say, it really hurts me to say, I'm fine, thank you, and how are you on the Game Drive radio? When I did my training, there was absolutely no way you were allowed to do that. And somebody, you won't believe it today, David, on the Game Drive channel said a bad word. They swore. Terrible. dreadful behaviour. Well, that little thing on its back is quite astounding. Little lioness. She's enjoying her childhood, as all lionesses should, and indeed all young mammals. As I said this morning, I'm reminded of my nephews, William and Jack. And William and Jack enjoying their lives in Johannesburg as plump little toddlers, much like these lionesses. I do hope their mother isn't watching. If I describe them as plump little toddlers, I may be in trouble next time I go to Johannesburg. But it's not meant as an insult at all. Without a care in the world, and it's exactly the same as it is with these lionesses. Yeah, Doodle, this is the good question that is inevitably asked when we're looking at little lion cubs. You say, at what age will they be safe from the attentions of... Well, you see the other lioness there? One of the lionesses has departed, everyone. She might be stalking Dave from behind, but we'll notice that. If the camera jerks suddenly, it's Dave being removed from the back of the car. Doodle, they'll be safe from marauding males only after they're probably at least a year old, but preferably two. So somewhere between a year and 2 years, they're safe. I have read a year old. I've seen a year old, but I've also seen cubs or sub-adults sort of between a year and a half old being killed. So it really does. It's not a fixed thing, but a year old is about the minimum normally. You see her there, Dave? You can. What's she doing? She's sniffing around, is she? She's not sniffing at the tire next to you. No, good. Excellent. And they're all watching. All the little cubbies are now watching her. Interested. They are beyond speech, these things. They are so cute, it is almost unfathomable. The desire to get out and go and pick one up is almost overwhelming. Until you look to the side and see their mothers. And then you realise that would be a very silly idea indeed. Were you to catch one of these things, you'd find that they weren't quite as sweet as they look. I think you'd find that their claws and teeth are already well developed enough. Ooh, right here, David. Just walking past. Hello. Nothing to see here. Keep going. That's it. I'm just going to help Abel to get in here. I think Ephraim is also trying to respond here. We might have to leave, but I don't think we will. I think we're going to be okay to stay here for a little while longer. We have had a magnificent afternoon with them if they do decide that one or two more people wish to come in here. Eating a stick always a good idea as a youngster, David? Yes. I like to eat sticks, even at my advanced age. Oh, look at this little thing very close to us, David. I think I might take a photograph of him. Yes, a world beater. I can just get it in focus. No, that's not going to be a world beater. It wasn't in focus. Lion's eyes were shut. That one missed the foot. It's so sweet, isn't it? Hello. Do you want to come over here? If you do, don't tell your mother. Just wander over. You can come and sit on my lap for a little while, scratch you behind your ears, and then you can go back. Just too much, these things. The little feet. Hello, Roger. You're wondering whether they have killed an impala, perhaps, last night, and because they don't look too hungry. I don't know. They could have easily, Roger. You know, as I've said to you before, quite easily that they kill impala very often, and we just don't see it. Of course, and that's because we are... Well, they would devour it. Five lionesses would devour an impala in less than half an hour. I think, Roger, most likely, however, is that they haven't bothered to go hunting since they ate that buffalo last. So, no, I'm going to say no, I don't think they have. But it's certainly not impossible. Enjoyable to sit here with them. The temperature slowly starting to drop now as the sun begins its inexorable sinking towards the western horizon, where it will eventually sink beyond the Drakensberg Mountains. And back on Cheetah Plains, Miss Jamie the Elegant Antelope Patterson is with some more elephants.
Seems to be an elephant-themed afternoon this afternoon, and I just can't bring myself to leave a sighting as magnificent as this. All of our lovely elephants have calmed down and they've spread out, found their individual feeding spots for now, and it's just such a perfect picture as the sun starts to go down and the light starts to turn golden. I really do enjoy just spending time with them. Oh, she's so pregnant. I've just realized. I wondered why she looked so enormous. She is a pregnant lady. And in fact, she's so pregnant that I think she might almost be on the verge of lactating. Just having a look at the mammary glands that I saw briefly while she was walking. They look swollen to me. It looks like she may well be on the verge of giving birth. An elephant is a massive animal, I mean, that goes without saying, but in terms of looking for signs of pregnancy, the elephant's females carry their pregnancies quite high, if I could say it like that. So they tend to bulge upwards towards the sort of outwards from their spines, more so than an unpregnant cow. And that's one of the ways that you can look for it. And towards the end of their 22-month gestation period, and you can imagine that they start to become quite large, cumbersome, and quite uncomfortable. She's done very well to carry that particular calf to full term. And I wish her all the best because she's got some seriously tough times ahead of her unless we get some rain in the not too distant future. To support herself and a calf is going to be incredibly difficult. And Cindy in Florida, lovely to have you on board. I do hope you are enjoying this elephant sighting. Just watching, I'm keeping an eye on this little calf that's playing about in front of me. But before we go on to that little calf, Cindy, you're wondering about the trees with green leaves, because of course we keep going on about the drought, and then every now and again you get this bright green flash of gwari tree, or gwari bush, like this one in front of us. Yes, they are the trees that the animals don't eat. They don't have very much in the way of nutrition, and they're very, very high in tannin contents. So they're very bitter and unpleasant for the animals to eat. So when you see the animals eating gwari bushes, you know immediately that they are really starting to get particularly desperate. Those bright flashes of green. The gwari bushes are the ones that keep their leaves throughout the years, which means they're very useful in terms of acting as something like a fire beater, perhaps. Or, as we saw this morning with the Wahlberg's eagle, a really, really nice padding for their nests. But they're not very high in nutrients at all, so the elephants and the other creatures tend to avoid them. One of the big reasons that's been put forward as to why the lions and leopards urine spray on gwari bushes, because they maintain their leaves and then obviously keep the scent for that little bit longer. Yes, little one. She's so cute. Running off into the shade to join in. There you go, you've got a young elephant eating some of the gwaris. Gwari, by the way, for newer viewers, is spelt G-U-A-R-R-I. It's the Euclea divinorum tree. And whenever we talk about how incredibly dry and dusty it is, we always somehow manage to find a gwari bush in frame that sort of makes us look silly. But they don't have much in the way of nutrients at all. A tuskless female, or she's, I'm not sure if she's tuskless or if she's got one tusk. I think she is tuskless at the back. There you go, you can see. The wind is gusting, so I'm giving the elephants quite a lot of personal space. They seem to be perfectly relaxed, but I want to make sure that we don't upset them in any way. Really, it's getting stronger and stronger. I don't know if there's some kind of cold front blowing in or if it's just the spring winds bringing with it. We actually don't really enjoy the wind here because it's going to increase the evaporation effect of the heat even more so than it would otherwise without the wind. Let's shuffle forward a bit. As we wait for, I just want to stop here so that we don't block the rest of the herd from moving past us. As we wait for the rest of the herd, Jane in Massachusetts, lovely to have you on board on the Sunset Safari. You wanted to know how elephants sleep. And the answer is they can lie down, although it's quite unusual for the adults to do that. Little calves will go and lie down and pass out for an hour, with the whole herd protectively around them, making sure that they are safe while they nap. As they start to get older, they sleep less and less until, for the adults, they'll take short naps, maybe 5, 10, up to 20 minutes at a time. Usually, leaning against it, they can just sleep standing up. They might go and lean against a tree or a termite mound. In exceptional circumstances, they will lie down flat. And I've come upon male, full-grown male elephants lying down completely flat on their side. I thought it was a dead elephant, until I realized that it was just an elephant bull fast asleep. They can lie down. Getting up is always a bit of a tricky experience for the bigger elephants because, as you can imagine, hoisting that bulk back onto their feet is a tough process, which is why they generally prefer to lean on trees or termite mounds or sandbanks, somewhere where they've got a bit of a give back up again. Look at them all gathered here. Such a peaceful scene. We've just got elephants spread out around us. What you got, little one? Got a dried up stick. It seems as though this afternoon's Monday sunset safari is a thoroughly peaceful one, filled with scenes of family contentment. And speaking of scenes of family contentment, let's go back over to the lovely Nkuhuma Pride.
As she linked there, everybody, she said lovely, and I thought that's so kind of her. And then she said Nkuhuma Pride and not James Hendry. And I'm obviously abjectly pained in my heart. Anyway, we're here with the lions, and they're very lovely to see. Not much going on, other than the inevitable, unspeakable cuteness of the lions. Now this little fellow, teddy bear lion, trying to eat some buffalo dung, and then going to play with his slightly older cousin. Oh no, man. I mean, that's, you can't even watch that. Hey? Just unbelievable. I think it's the fluffiness of them as well. And they don't rest, you know, they haven't been completely rested at all. Fiona, You're wondering, you say, do lions like to sleep near elephant dung, or is it a function of the amount of elephant dung it is? It's a function of the amount of elephant dung that there is. They don't have any real desire to sleep next to elephant dung. It's just that there is elephant dung absolutely everywhere, especially now, anywhere near shade, because all of the open areas are denuded of any kind of grass, so there's nothing for the elephants to eat there. They come through these areas where there's a bit of wood, and there's still something for them to eat, and they walk through the sort of more heavily woodland areas, and they will make their fertilization deposits. And the lions will almost inevitably therefore find themselves lying in amongst the very fragrant and gorgeous smelling elephant dung. Elephant dung, for those of you who don't know, when it comes out, it smells a bit ripe, but after a few days in the sun, it is the most wonderful smelling stuff. Well, most wonderful is probably a bit strong, but it is very pleasant to smell. And there's no bullying going on, you can see. No bullying at all going on between the older cubs and the younger ones. And it's interesting, you know, it's so indicative and so different from, for example, a wolf pack or a wild dog pack, where there will be bullying. And there's and even in the hyena clan, where the bullying sorts out who is going to be the alpha, who is going to be the dominant, in the case of the wolf pack or the wild dog pack. But in the case, look at that, the mum's just gone over to the one that's been sleeping quietly on his own. And it's almost like she's gone to say, "Are you all right over here? Why aren't you playing with the others? Are you all right?" That little one has been fast asleep there on his own for at least 20 minutes, and now mum's gone over to see if he's okay. Isn't that sweet? "Yes. Are you all right? You feeling a little peaky, are you?" Hello, Sarah. Nice question from you. You say, "Have I noticed the cub with the old injury from a while back?" No, I haven't, Sarah, and that's because that injury, I believe, it has healed completely. And I was just thinking about that now. Of course, there were dire predictions of the fate that poor animal was going to suffer. At various stages, it had broken its pelvis, it had broken a femur, it had dislocated its hip, it had almost certainly suffered some kind of terrible spinal injury, and we can't find that one anymore. It's absolutely healed, completely fine, nothing wrong with it at all, Sarah. They're amazingly resilient. Look at this little ridiculousness here. You see that one there, Davy? Fast asleep now. Natasha, you say, "Why are some of the babies looking more pale than the others?" They are, you're absolutely correct. You're not missing that at all. It's a function of their age, Tasha, I think. And the older ones do seem to be a bit darker, I must say. But if you look, Davey, if you go in on that one, you're on there. No, the other one, you're on that one. You can see there is a mantle of black or dark hair at the back. And I think that expands slightly as they get a little bit older. And then it goes again as they're adults. And I think that probably helps them to hide in the thick bushes when they are trying to stay undetected while their mothers hunt. I'm interested by that one at the back there, and for the length of time that it's been asleep, I wonder if it isn't feeling a little bit ill. Maybe there is some little minor infection it's suffering from. It might just be a lazy lion, which certainly wouldn't be the first lion in the world to have been described as such. I did also get into quite a lot of trouble to begin with when I began this job. I referred to Junior, the Nkuhuma male lion, as being lazy once or twice too often. There was an outcry on Twitter, the insult that I was subjecting Junior to. Anyway, Poor old Junior. I wonder where he is. I'd so love to find out how he's going and what he's doing with his new coalition partner. We think he formed a coalition. Now, we were talking about sleep, and I read something today on a website that is a very good news website, but not necessarily renowned for its accurate biology. And it said that giraffes sleep for 7 to 30 minutes of a day. Now, I would have thought that was utter rubbish. So I would have said they sleep for probably 5 or 6 hours a day. And I'd love to know if anybody has anything further to say on the matter. Does a giraffe really sleep for 7 to 30 minutes a day? Or do they, I mean, that's in a 24-hour period, or do they sleep for much longer? Because I would have said 5 or 6 hours. While we look at these lions, the sun now starting to sink gently below, well, not to the horizon yet, but the light is turning from that pale, kind of washed-out white colour to this lovely yellow gold. And soon they will be backlit, David. Ooh. Now you see, this is a wonderful question from Safari Ginny in Canada. Safari Ginny, you say, will the mothers stop lactating when their cubs are 6 months old at weaning, or only when the oldest cubs are 6 months old? My gut instinct, Safari Ginny, says to me the latter, that they, as long as the sort of lactating stimulus is there, so as long as there's a youngster trying to suckle from them, I think they will continue producing milk. In the same way that I think, as far as I understand it, with a human being, a woman will stop producing milk after her baby stops suckling. Is that correct? I think that's correct. And the longer the child keeps suckling, that stimulus, that action of nursing and suckling stimulates the production of milk. Is that correct? Kirsten says she thinks so. David is giggling. Are you giggling at our friend there? Yes. The other game drive who asked me how I was on the game drive channel is now leaving, having spent precisely 3.5 minutes with possibly the top sighting on the reserve. Ah, well. That is the thing about being a guide, of course, these days, is that it's a great big rush to get from one sighting to the other. We don't have to do that, A, because we have an audience that is on safari more often than guests in the area, and also because we have basically you're on two game drives at the same time. I'm just going to help Ephraim get in here. If there's space in here for three cars, but now Abel is leaving, but absolutely there's space for three. Now Ephraim from Cheetah Plains is going to come. And this is a very good time. If you are a guide, this is a good time to come in here, of course, because when you come in here at this time of the day, it's normal that the lionesses are starting to get a little bit active. Right, still on Cheetah Plains, still with the elephants, the still inevitably elegant Jamie Patterson.
James is absolutely correct. Still on Cheetah Plains and still with our lovely elephant herd. The one thing that has changed is the wind, which is getting worse every single moment that we're out here. It is now starting to howl, and my plan about going to the open area, I think I may have changed my mind about that particular spot. It's bad enough here where we are, which is quite open. It's starting to gust. It wants to take my hat off. Definitely a very, very windy afternoon. There's the tuskless female, so she is tuskless. Sorry, not another one, it's the same one. with her little calf. For newer viewers, to see an elephant without tusks is not a usual occurrence here, but it is not all that unusual. It's about 4% of them. Debbie, you were wondering what causes some elephants to be tuskless. It is just a genetic abnormality. They don't grow tusks at all. As you know, tusks are modified incisor teeth, very strange sort of setup, very, very unusual in terms of the way that they have grown with elephants. And sometimes you get all kinds of bizarre abnormalities. We've seen some with backward facing tusks. There's some with split tusks that have turned into one or two tusks sticking out of the same sort of place. And the tuskless elephant, sorry, there's dust blowing around, it's just gone straight into my eye. The tuskless elephant is about 4% of the population that experience that particular situation. Now, I think that calf, not quite old enough to know yet whether or not it has inherited mom's tuskless nature. Quite often, I've noticed that tuskless females tend to be slightly more on edge than the tusked females. I don't know if that's just because they feel more vulnerable, or if it's just perhaps a conclusion that I've drawn that's purely coincidental. I've just noticed that quite a few of the tuskless females in my experience have been a bit more unsettled with my presence than others. Look at this little baby underneath the tree, keeping itself thoroughly busy and entertained. They don't need to eat as often as the adults do. What are you doing? And darkness has descended upon Cheetah Plains very quickly. In a bizarre turn of affairs, we have no picture, but I can still talk to you. Would you like a radio show, Safari Live Radio? Perhaps not. Perhaps while we figure out why your picture has disappeared off your screens, it might be an idea to send you over to James.
There is David being very artistic, everybody. This is called a rack focus on the sunset. Is that correct, David? Well done. A very nice rack focus on the sunset there. Beautiful. The gwarri bushes gently blowing in the northwesterly breeze, rustling their leaves. And in the background, you might just be able to hear the very cross little lion cubs as they try and feed from their mother. David, that was very artistically special, I must confess. I wish I could take a photograph like that. Unfortunately, I am incompetent and cannot. Yes, that's exactly the correct response. Marvellous. That one is now watching his siblings as they attempt to do each other harm. And everyone thinking about having something nice to eat. I wonder what radio safari would be like. I think it'd be quite fun. I've no doubt Jamie Patterson could pull off a radio safari. I think we should ask her to do it one day. Now I'm just going to try and help Ephraim into the sighting while these lions behave like lions. Look at them growling and cross with each other now, and Mum's getting sick and tired of it. Leaving a great pile of lion cubs there. It is relentless. One or other of them is being assailed constantly by these cubs. Sorry, my head is in the way. Assailed by the hungry little things there, straight back on. And I think it's fine when they're one or two, but when there are five or six of them, it becomes trying, I imagine. In the background there, a ring-necked dove. I tell you, who would be a lioness? Not an easy life. And now the games are getting a little bit more rough and tumble as we head towards the sunset. Things have cooled down a bit. I think that's three of different ages there. Oh, that's a wonderful shot. Isn't that nice? But if we went round the other side, I could have had a photograph of them. Not unless they'd been really tired and lain there for 4 hours while I managed to prepare myself. So sweet. I'm just going to ask... never mind. Ephraim is breaking down. Tasha, you're wandering around blue-eyed lions and wondering if the cubs ever actually manage to keep their blue eyes into adulthood. I've never seen a tawny lioness with... I've never seen a tawny lioness with blue eyes, but I have seen... I think those white lions maintain their blue eyes, interestingly. So the white lions, leucistic form of the lion, the standard issue lion, and I think, if I'm not mistaken, they maintain the blue eyes. But I've never seen an adult male or an adult lioness, a tawny coloured one with blue eyes, no. But it may be somebody can have a quick look and see if a white lion doesn't have blue eyes. I used to have blue eyes, David, you know that?
Yes.
Apparently they're green. I find it difficult to tell myself. It's because I'm getting old now. What's a what?
Steenbok.
A steenbok? Good heavens, we mustn't stay here any longer. Jamie's got a steenbok, everybody.
This might be the bravest steenbok in all of the cheetah plains. We are so incredibly close. Well, for a steenbok sighting at least. And look at him. He's not even bothered. Busy nibbling away at the raisin bush in front of him. I wish he'd come back out again. I'm too scared to move now. We just had such a perfect view of his beautiful little face. They really are stunning antelope, the little steenbok. Or, as James called one yesterday, a steenbok. Look at their enormous bright eyes and his massive ears and tiny little horns. Hello, gorgeous. Aren't you so brave? I don't think it gets better than this in terms of steenbok sightings. You can see him blinking whenever he gets a little bit too close to the branches and the spines, and they go close to his eyes. Absolutely stunning view. Close enough to see the flies fluttering about him and his dainty little legs. Quite unusual to see a steenbok out in the open like this. We're on the open area of Cheetah Plains. Look at that. Dainty crossed legs. Wow. I really don't think I've ever had a steenbok sit still this long or stand still this long. Sorry. Kirsty's made me laugh. She said those are like your legs. Thanks, Kirst. Look at it nibble away. It's beautiful. I love the white eyeliner as well, or the eyeshadow, I suppose. Just that little highlight nuance. And the otherwise tan skin or tan fur. And then those little dagger-like horns, not to be underestimated. And then it looks like somebody put a strip of paint along the top of its nose. Chandra, I don't think I've ever had a steerbok. I don't think I've ever had a steerbok stay still this long. Oh, thought about running. No, still here. This is incredible. For newer viewers, a lot of the time what we see of a steerbok is it disappearing into the distance as it races away from us. Having a sighting like this is an absolute pleasure. Enormous ears and eyes, of course, immediately tell you that this is an animal that spends its life looking out for predators and runs the risk of being hunted constantly. Those giant radar-like ears that move independently to pinpoint the direction of a sound, the slightest creak, and then those enormous sideways-facing eyes to give it the biggest field of view possible. Hello. You are stunning. See where the name comes from. You are such a poser, little steerbok. See where the name comes from? Steen, sort of stone or brick, that bright red colour that the fur has. Oh, you're so strong. Look at you picking up that entire bush. Ears working reflexively, turning backwards and forwards. Making sure to keep an eye on us and whatever else is out there. Right, well, I think we found the star of the show. A perfect male steerbok. Joanne, you were wondering about how tall they are at the shoulder. And the answer is, well, I'm 5'7", to give you a rough idea, and the steerbok would come about sort of to my knee height, maybe even just a little bit below that. So well under a foot in height, about half a foot, I would say. But yeah, it would come up to about just underneath my knee. So they are absolutely minute little creatures. Duck away. This probably, I mean, we could see a Sharp's graspok out here. But it's highly, highly unlikely. So the steerbok is probably the smallest antelope species that you're going to see on these live safari drives. Although I have to tell you, if we saw a Sharp's graspok, we would all be beside ourselves with excitement. They're relatively rare in this part of the Sabi Sand. I think that's a perfect description coming through from Doodle, who said that steerbok look as though they might belong in a fairy tale forest with their huge ears and eyes and their beautiful little noses. I couldn't agree more. It's like a Disney antelope, isn't it? Little Disney character, especially this one. I feel like if I start singing, it will come up and feed from my hand. No. No. Oh no, where's Steve? No, Steve! He was here the whole time. He was here with those elephants. He's on the first day. Oh, there we go. Phew. Oh, Steve. I was so worried. Sorry, the fairy tale song reminded me. All right. He's on the first aid kit, everybody. Panic is over. Crisis averted. Steve is okay. He has not been taken by a hornbill. Phew. It was the fairy tale comment that made me think of it. There we go. Sean. If I sing to you, will you come and feed from my hand, little steerbok? As long as he doesn't eat Steve. Valid point. That would be a terrifying end to the fairy tale. I can't believe how brave this little stembok is. It's so incredibly comfortable with our presence. Barely glances in our direction every now and again. Come on, now you've gone into exactly the wrong spot. You're meant to be the star of this. Like the South African version of Bambi. Okay, let's see what happens when we turn on. Let's let the engine run for a little bit. So that we don't have the sudden noise and the sudden movement all at the same time. Softly, softly. Right next to the culvert that drains the road. And the stembok could not be less bothered by us. It's amazing. When we think of the sightings that we have where they are immediately dashing off in the opposite direction. Should we try going round? Let's try it. Might as well. You're a very brave stembok. Very unprotected out here in the open. But I suppose... for the little stembok, it's almost a comfort. Wait for a sec. Because chances are he'd spot anything trying to sneak up on him. Helen has said I must have a Snow White effect on the animals. I think there's a couple of elephants that would disagree with you, Helen. but I appreciate the compliment. Snow White with the most freckles in any fairy tale. But thank you very much. What a lovely compliment. Let's try and sneak up on the stembok. I'm not going to sing though. Trust me, you'll take back everything. And Sarah, you were wondering why it is by itself? Well, stembok or solitary antelope? When they're foraging. So what actually they do is they live in pairs, a male and a female, all on their own, and the male and the female will raise their offspring together. They have tiny little territories, but they spend most of their day separate. Oh, bye-bye. And just like that, our stembok is off. Bye-bye, little one. Thank you for that particular sighting. So Sarah, they live in monogamous pairs, so they mate for life and they have their own little territory, their little home that they live in. But they do go off separately during the day and they go and forage and look for food. So the female is, he might be a male still looking for a female, still looking for a mate. But his female could also just be somewhere in the general vicinity feeding off on her own. Well, that's beautiful. And as the sun starts to descend, another beautiful evening, I think that James and myself, well, we started off this morning both looking at the sunrise, and I think it seems only fitting that we start to enter into the final part of the day by both looking at the sunset.
Well, you see, that's the thing about Jamie Patterson. She's just got such a rounded kind of outlook on life. And as she says, we should end the day in the same way that we started it. And there it is. Although I don't think I'm going to end my day with two salty cracks and a cup of black coffee. That is how I began my day. And with a cold shower, of course, David. Yes. One should have a cold shower to wake up. Well, you can't have a cold shower, David, because you have long hair. Which means that you will be freezing in the morning. No. I remember, this has got nothing to do with the lions, everybody, but because we can just enjoy watching them. I'm not really sure what else to tell you about them at this stage, but I remember when I was about 19, David, my father, was shocked that I hadn't shaved. He was scandalized, in fact. And I said, well, you know, I was camping. I didn't have a chance to shave. There was only cold water. He said, my father fought in the trenches, which he did, and he shaved every day in a small billy of cold water. You have no excuse for your camping trip, which I couldn't really argue with. He still comments almost on a daily basis that I am unshaven. He doesn't realize that I'm trying to look manly and tough, you see. I tell him that Jason Statham doesn't shave either, but he doesn't seem to give too much cognizance to that. Right, back to the lions. You know that perhaps it's a story that you had to be there for when there's just nothing but a stony cricket silence from the final control. We do want to get that, everybody. We want to get a sound effect of crickets calling in the night when a presenter makes a joke that really isn't very funny at all, and Kirsten or Louise or Jerry or Rebecca can push it and it can go crick 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 crick, just to ease the tension a little bit after a poor joke. Kirsten has just said, she is of course the meanest person in the world, she just said it would be on a continuous loop, the cricket sound with my presenting. Thank you, Kirsten. I hope you, well, now I'm not going to say, never mind. Hello, James Ben, Missouri. We were talking about radio safaris, and you were saying that you've got a friend in Namibia who goes out, and when he looks at animals, he talks to you on his vehicle radio, and you find it amazing to listen to his descriptions of the animals and scenes that he sees. I think that's brilliant, and I think that if you could actually manage to take a safari and bring it alive to people just through words, well, you'd be pretty skillful, certainly much more skillful than I am. These things are just so very sweet. I thought they were going to get up and start... Oh my goodness, David, just look over there, sorry. There is a cub that is basically asleep on its mother's side. You see that? Look at that. It's gone to sleep there. Oh, it was, just before I said, have a look at that. That, of course, is the best place to go to sleep, isn't it? Oh, it's so sweet. Oh, and then just turn around and have a bit of a drink. Wonderful. The sun has now set. You see that, David? Well, it's almost set. Let us, as Jamie says, be... end the day as we began it, actually watching the sun dip down below the western horizon, spraying the area in gold and orange. What other colours have you got there, David?
A couple of blues.
A couple of blues, yes.
A purple, actually.
A purple? Slightly.
Slightly purple.
Not my favourite colour, purple. I suppose in a sunset it's okay. Right, once the sun has gone down, everyone, we're going to slowly make our way out of here, just because we don't want to be here in the dark. And I think we've had an incredible time with these little cubbies and their mummies and aunties. And we'll go and see what else we can find. I don't imagine between now and then it'll be too much, but perhaps a leopard will have popped onto the reserve. So what we'll do is we'll head down towards Twin Dams and come up again for the last half hour. Absolutely unbelievable. Jamie Patterson for the last 3 days has been filming these things for her hero shots, which will be a 15-second sort of promo on who she is for National Geographic. Gendre has probably captured about 700 gigabytes of high-definition footage for this 15-second shot, and indeed they're back at it as we speak. So we're going to stay with the lions for a bit longer. Well, I mean, that's hardly a hardship for anybody, is it? And the wind, it's amazing how as the sun sets, the wind starts to blow. And it's a northwester, which in summer can be a harbinger of a big storm. I don't think it's going to be today. I don't think we're going to have a storm at all. But it might be also worthwhile, rather than going towards the south, we could head up towards the west and just see if we can't get a view of if there's some weather perhaps gathering over the Drakensberg. Mum just giving youngster the bath before the evening. Very important, everybody. Child hygiene. And there we are. And baby trying to help mum have a bath as well. That is very sweet. And now trying to bite off her ear. Or her eye. Whatever he can get his little teeth into. So sweet. There's no ways you'd be able to spend 3 hours with lions if they didn't have cubs. You'd die of boredom in the middle of the day. But we've sat here now for 2.5 hours or so, and it's been constantly interesting. Them playing with each other, sleeping in outlandish positions, trying to suckle, having a bit of a fight, waking the mums up so that they have to move around as well. Oh, a good cat stretch. So sweet. Now they're all starting to get slightly more mobile, I suppose. One playing with a stick, two playing with a mum or an aunt, two playing with each other. I've got a little leaf there. You see that, David? It's the equivalent of lion Lego, I suppose. Gracie, aged 9, always asks about whether or not animals have things to play with. Well, there you are, Gracie. If you're watching today, you can see that they've got a little leaf to play with. So not quite, I suppose, from the top drawer of the sophisticated toys. But, you know, if you're a lion, you must make do with a leaf or some buffalo dung or something like that. Well, there's much cleaning going on now. It's so sweet. And you can imagine how comfortable that little cub is now. How in absolute ecstasy it is. You know that when you tickle your house cat or your dog, they just go into a state of absolute abject joy and they don't want you to stop. And that's why I think that little one is holding mum's face down. Don't stop, mum. Just see, they are, as with all cats, I suppose, they're just so tremendously affectionate. Until it comes to eating, of course. All right, everybody, the sun has set. We are now going to leave this sighting and carry on, see what else we might be able to pick up on our way out. Are you ready, David?
Yes, James.
It has been marvellous. Well, that is a wonderful, wonderful quote from Akwe. You say the cubs stare into our hearts, while the adults stare into our souls. They do, you know. Looking an adult lioness in the eyes or a male lion in the eyes, it absolutely feels like they're staring into the depths of your soul. I know exactly what you mean, Aqua. I remember the first time that old Amber Eyes stared me down. I was thoroughly intimidated, deeply afraid. Bye-bye, chaps. You've been wonderful. Have a good night. Stay safe, please. Find a bush. Stay silent if your mothers are not here. We'll see you, hopefully, in the morning. Now, David, you noticed, of course, because you were on the vehicle, the utterly incompetent manner in which I got into the current position. I'm hoping to do it without quite so much fuss this time. You weren't with us, everybody. I think you were looking at Stanley the stick insect. Was that his name? Steve. Sorry, Stevie. Stephen the stick insect. Ah, George, you say Steve is now the mascot of Safari Live. I certainly wouldn't have any objections to that, of course. Steve, the mascot of Safari Live, which was slightly difficult to sell, I think, you know. If you were, for example, trying to sell the product to a broadcaster and you sent them a covering letter or page or prospectus with a stick insect on the front of it, as opposed to one of the Nkuhuma cubs, for example. I fear me somebody might say, seriously? But I think a stick insect is a wonderful idea. Sharp, David. Hello, Helen in Melbourne. Really nice question from you. You say you're studying conservation ecology, and how does one become a guide? Well, that's precisely what I did, Helen. I did virtually the same sort of studies. And then, I mean, being a guide, with due respect to the guiding fraternity, and that is myself included, it's not rocket science. What it does take, though, is a little bit of experience, and it takes an enjoyment of communicating, obviously. And you can do various courses around the place that will help you to get the qualifications you need in order to do what we do here. And that, I mean, to do a lodge guiding course can take you from as little as 1 month, which is way too short. You can't be a competent guide after a month of training, up to about 6 months. I think that's the kind of length course you want to do before you are a lodge guide. And then once you're a lodge guide, to do what I do. The thing about doing what Jamie and Brent and I do is that because there's a lot of talking to be done, you've got to talk about lots of different things. It's quite nice to have sort of a year of experience or so under your belt, so that there's, or 2 years, 2 or 3 years experience under your belt, so that you can talk about lots of different things. And that's basically how you do it. But there are lots of different courses you can do out here for guiding. Some lodges do their own in-house training, some don't. And while we get out of this rather difficult area, let's head back to Jamie. Jandre has finished his 755th gigabyte of filming.
James is just making me laugh out loud, so I can only imagine what it must be like from your side as viewers. How much she must be keeping you thoroughly entertained. Well, I thought I'd show you a very pretty sunset. And it is a very pretty sunset. With these very classic silhouetted marula trees. Complete with what looks like a leopard lying in one of them. It's not a leopard, unfortunately. I really hoped it was a leopard, but it's not a leopard. It is just a branch. But it looks like it could be a leopard. There. Just there. Stretched out, fast asleep. Not today, though. I've managed to spot a few leopards in trees recently that aren't actually leopards. Aren't those colours incredible? The blues and the yellows and the pinks. Almost, but not quite, inspirational enough for me to break into song. But that's not going to happen today.
I think it is.
Gendre, you are mistaken.
Happened this morning.
It did happen, did it? Oh, yes, that's true. Actually, I did start singing the Lion King song as the sun rose. That is true. Orfeo, that is very true. Moving on, swiftly and with style, we're going to slowly make our way towards the setting sun. We've done completed our long journey to the east. It's now time for us to begin our long journey to the west. And back home towards Amanda's cooking, which is always something exciting. What's wrong, Impala? Sprinting across the road in front of me. Doesn't have that frantic look, though. I think it's just the males causing nonsense. And as soon as one starts to go, then they all follow. That herding instinct, incredibly powerful. Now here come the rest of them. Nimbly dashing across the road. It makes sense. You can't really afford to be that one impala that stops and stands and goes, why are we running? Because you never know. Might be everybody knows something that you don't, and it could be wild dogs chasing behind or something similar. So when one runs, they all go. It doesn't do to be cynical. There we go. Right, are you all done now? We've still got one. Have we got one? No, just one racing one in front of us. Okay, there we go. All done. They've all. Oh, no, there's the late one. Dashing across. Beautiful. I think they're just in high spirits as the temperature starts to drop and the males have been knocking horns with each other. All is calm, casual, and collected. All right. Onwards, for we have miles to go. Not quite miles. Well, yeah, a few miles. Before we reach the safety of home and Amanda's cooking. So I keep bumping into the elephants everywhere I go. We had to sort of slowly but surely weave our way in between that herd on our way out of here. They were a little bit antsy. They're still not all that happy. I think there's a couple of big bulls around. The wind at least has dropped though, which has definitely improved everything's mood. As we duck around this massive broken up marula tree, on the subject of impalas, Joyce, I don't think anybody's seen Nelson recently. Very nice. Very, very nice. Ah, no. I was so certain it was going to stay. Well done, Gendre. It was a black-bellied bustard standing in the road. Oh, it's going back down again. Okay, round the next corner. Let's go. Fingers crossed it decides to stay. Joyce, I haven't seen Nelson in forever. When was Nelson last seen? Those of you, I was on leave, so I'm not sure if he was seen whilst I was away. I think the last time must have been about a month and a half ago with Brent, possibly even more. I haven't seen Nelson in what feels like forever. Definitely saw it go down somewhere here. So Nelson, for new viewers who have missed out on our different characters, Nelson is one of the most famous impala in all the world. And that is the reason that we know it's Nelson and that we can identify him from the other 100,000 impala is the fact that he has one horn and one eye. Hence the name Nelson, for those of you who are history buffs. I tried to call him Harvey Dent, but I was shot down in flames for that, and he became Nelson. The one-horned, one-eyed impala with one ambition, which was just to stay alive. I'm sure he came down here. He's somewhere around here. I saw him Impala went dancing past, and always get to see that incredible display of physical athleticism, I suppose, would be the best description. Monique, the special little kicks that Impala do when wild dogs are around, it's another form, it's basically a form of stotting. So stotting is when an antelope, I've lost him, I don't know where he went, searched high and low. Stotting is, for those of you who didn't know, it is a way of, an antelope's way of showing off. And it's basically the antelope saying, don't challenge me, I'm big and I'm fit and strong and fast, and you might as well not even bother because I'll just outrun you. It's showing off, essentially. And they do it with each other, and they do it with predators as well. And they probably find that the little kicks that Impala do in alarm and panic may well be a form of stotting to show off how big and or how strong and healthy they are. Not necessarily big, but just strong and healthy. And the Impala have an amazing variety of stotting. They do these enormous bounding leaps, and they also do those incredible handstands where they essentially flick their back feet over their shoulders, and the whole back arches in this beautiful shape. How they do it and don't break, I don't know. I definitely couldn't do that. It is amazing to witness. And those, the most famous, I think, of all of the stotting styles of all antelope must be those of the springbuck. And the springbuck does a very special style of stotting known as pronking. This sentence is starting to get confusing with the stotting and the pronking, but essentially what pronking is, it's when the springbuck jump up and they draw all four limbs close together and they arch their back up high and they spring almost in slow motion up into the air. Massive, massive jumps. And that is a form of stotting called pronking, and it's completely unique to springbuck. We don't get springbuck in this particular area, but they are essentially the arid equivalent of impala. I'm so disappointed that black-bellied bustard looked amazing, and I was hoping it might even give us its call. And just speaking of birds and calling, actually, we're going into ground hornbill nesting season soon. So they start to call now from October, still got a couple of weeks, but it's something that we're going to be keeping an eye out for, because you never know when a ground hornbill family might decide to nest in our Traverse area, and that's something that would be incredibly exciting for those critically endangered birds. Well, we skip past three in a row pan and continue on our journey to the west. Let's find out what James has planned for his last few moments of the sunset safari.
It is blowing up with something of a gale from the northwest now, and I've just come to this area so that you can see the mountains. We'll go a little bit further and then I shall stop. In fact, I shall stop right here because there are some impala crossing the road. Do you see them, David? There they are. Yes. Very nice. Now, what I wanted to show you, of course, is the fact that the mountains are visible in the background there, and they are not, in fact, covered in a burgeoning storm that might dump some water on us. They are covered in some smoke and some haze and some dust, and that's because of the wind. There's possibly a forestry fire up there, and of course, it is the time of the year when the little bit of rangeland that has grass on it left will be burned in order to stimulate the new green growth for the spring. And that's why that is a hazy horizon. And I don't think it's going to clean until we get either a very severe cold front coming through, or until we've had some rain to wash the dust out of the air. Those impala have decided that they'd like to be on Biffle's Hook for the evening. Obviously they're going to some kind of eating jaunt. That is what they do on a Monday evening. David, what are you going to do tonight? Is something special? Have you got anything special planned? Is it movie night tonight? What is the movie?
The Gods Must Be Crazy.
Really?
Yes.
Oh, I see. Now, everybody, if you have not seen The Gods Must Be Crazy, do yourself a favour. It is a fantastic film. Let's go back to the other member of the black-bellied bustard family that we get here with Jamie. Jamie isn't that one. It's the bird that she's looking at that I'm referring to.
Don't think I'm a member of the black-bellied bustard family. I think my parents would be very surprised if I was. But we do have a red-crested corhan, and I'm really hoping that it's going to call for us. Excuse me.
Merci.
Thank you. I've done so well. I'm definitely... Oh dear. Sorry, there we go. All right. So the red-crested corhan, another bird that we're going into breeding season with, and I can hear one calling not too far away from where we are. And I'm hoping that our gentleman might start to whistle in return. He keeps moving further and further away from us. Very high-pitched. But I can't imitate it well enough to trick this particular individual into thinking that I am indeed a member of the bustard family. They've also got an incredible... It's something that I've been trying to get on these live safaris since I started working here over a year ago, which was the mating display of a red-crested corhan, where they fly right up into the air and then they close their wings and come tumbling towards the ground at a very high speed, only to open their wings right at the last moment. And the females, for some inexplicable reason, find this display of stupidity incredibly attractive. Yes, I suppose maybe not that incredible, actually. It's something that I've really struggled to get on camera. They're quite skittish. And this one's already now moved off almost completely. But it is fantastic to witness it. Given them a nickname, they're the suicide bird, since it looks like they are committing suicide. And it's something that can be quite terrifying. I've had one fall out of the sky once close to falling onto my bonnet of my car, or the hood, as you call it in the States. The hood of the car. Yes, it's the hood. The hood of the car. I get confused between that and the boot and the trunk. We call the back the end the boot, and you call it the trunk. Anyway, never mind. So yes, I was tumbling out of the sky, and it nearly landed on my hood. Sounds ridiculous. I don't know why. For some reason, that's the one word that I really struggle with, because this to me is a bonnet of my car, which I suppose is equally stupid, I suppose. That's the bonnet, also known as the hood. Can't take it seriously. Anyway, moving on. It's called a red-crested corhan because it actually has a red crest. Go figure. But it's usually flat, hidden beneath a sort of a bluish patch of fur. And you hardly ever get to see it. So that's something to add to our list of things we need to put on Safari Live. The suicide birds, or the red-crested corhans, tumble out of the sky, and its red crest, which I don't think I've managed. I'm not sure if any of the other current guides have managed. I think he's disappeared for now. And I've turned my lights on, but it's pretty much a superfluous action at this point. Summer is definitely on its way. Our days are getting lovely and long. And at some point we will be changing the times. Not just yet. Nobody panic. Not just yet. We will keep you updated as to when that happens. But at some point we will have to shift the sunset safaris a little bit. The best time to be out on a safari, of course, is first thing in the morning and in the afternoon, when your nocturnal animals are more likely to be moving about. It's not too hot. The nocturnal animals might even still be kicking around if you're lucky. I love it! This has come through from Karen. He said, with our new member of the Safari Live team, Steve the Stick Insect, our new logo should be Stick Around with Safari Live. I like it. Catchy. What else could we have? There must be more. Stick, stick, No, I think Karin's got the best one. I can't think of anything better. Hey, Steve, what do you think? He says he's happy on the first aid kit, and please don't bug him anymore. Ha, bug him. I think the madness has descended. Kirsty, can we get a cricket track for me as well, please? She casually just goes, yo, you need one. Anyway, it's time for me on that note, because I think that the madness has well and truly set in. It is time for me to say a big farewell and a big thank you to all of you for joining us from across the corners of the globe. So thank you to Jandre, and thank you to you all. We'll catch up with you tomorrow on the Sunrise Safari. Bye-bye, everybody.
I was just saying to David that, do you remember at school when you had to do that thing known as the impromptu speech, when you were given some random topic? Come on, Rusty, you old bag. And that minute, you had to then go and stand in front of the class and talk for a minute, and how that minute felt like at least a century. And I was just saying, well, you know, a game drive out here is a bit like a three-hour impromptu speech. I mean, I wish I could have had this experience before I had to do the impromptu speech at school. There's always one or two in the class who stood up there and went, mountains. And there would be that unspeakably cringeworthy 40 seconds before they managed to get a word out. Mountains are big, and we went there on our last holiday. How much longer, ma'am? 20 seconds. Oh. We're doing okay there, Dave. Yes. There we are again. The crickets, I can hear them coming out of the final control. Crick, crick. Crick, crick. Crick, crick. I had a girlfriend once who made cricket sounds every time I made a joke. She didn't have a sense of humour, of course. Right, we've got a few minutes left to drive, everybody. I'm now speechless now that I've brought up the subject of the impromptu speech. I don't know what to say to you anymore. So I'll tell you that we will obviously have a sunrise safari tomorrow, but you probably already knew that. Mm-hmm. Ah, now many of you, thank you for providing me with a topic for conversation. You've said that you've loved The Gods Must Be Crazy, which is that wonderful film by Jamie Ace about the sand bushman, and quite a lot of life lessons in besides. And I think it was a wonderful, wonderful show. What on earth is going on there, David? Seems to be some kind of party. We were going to go down that road, but we're not anymore because there's a very large party going on there. And if you haven't seen it, it's about a sand bushman, and the whole premise of the thing is that a Coke bottle gets dropped out of an aeroplane into the middle of the Kalahari, where there aren't even stones, and how this thing, this object, becomes so incredibly useful, and then it becomes a source of conflict within the little group because everyone wants it, and it's the concept of ownership that didn't exist before. And it's an amazing, amazing film. It's a little bit dated perhaps, but it is an interesting film. We're now on quarantine clearings, hoping for one last sighting of an animal or something with a heartbeat, so that I might not have to talk utter rubbish to you for the last few minutes. Ah, we have crickets playing in the final control now. There's an impala. I'm feeling so distraught now. They were playing crickets, David. It wasn't very nice of them, was it? This is a confidence game, you know. All right, everybody. That's they're still going. That's going to be it from us. You can have a last look at some impala. A big thank you to all of you for joining us on what wasn't a tremendous trial of a drive with the lions and the elephants. Thanks to Jamie and Jandre and Cheetah Plains. And a big thank you to you, David, for your efforts today. And of course, Kirsten McLennan Smith, the meanest person in the world, and Geraldine, the sorest knee in the world. We will see you all tomorrow at 6 o'clock. I hope you've had a good time. Bye-bye.